Merry Christmas, everybody. I'm excited to read to you from Luke chapter 2, verse 8 through 10. For a lot of people, when they hear the song Chestnuts Roasting on an Open Fire, it warms the heart. But for other people, that's a fiery tribulation that causes them depression. Science is showing us that depression actually skyrockets during Christmas time because it brings up nostalgic memories, perhaps of loved ones who are no longer with us. In fact, there was a study that came out recently that showed us that 8 out of 10 people are stressed. So far from the holidays bringing people hope, sometimes it can bring people heartache, heartbreak, and anxiety. But we survive because the fire inside us burns brighter than the fire around us. God is a consuming fire. And because he is in me, the storm cannot take me where God cannot keep me. Wrong will be worsted, right will triumph. We are baffled to fight better. We sleep to wake. We fall to rise. We might have hell around us, but we have heaven inside us. We might bear a cross today, but we are going to wear a crown tomorrow. Because when chestnuts are roasting on an open fire, we know that God is a consuming fire. And this fire never burns me. It only burns what I am not. Come on, man. We have good news. Great tidings of glad joy. Now, here's the thing. Knowing the good news of God's love that Jesus was born into this world to proclaim, the Bible says this casts out all our fear. The good news of God's love casts out all our fear. God's love is the coal that makes the train roll. Star Wars is really big right now again during this Christmas season. And let me tell you, God's love is the most powerful force in the universe. May that force be with you. Can I get an amen? Listen, if our greatest need had been information, God would have sent us an educator. If our greatest need had been technology, God would have sent us a scientist. If our greatest need had been pleasure, God would have sent us an entertainer. If our greatest need had been money, God would have sent us an economist. But our greatest need was love, so God sent us a savior. And this Christmas season is celebrating the good news of God's love, which is what the angels proclaim. Luke chapter 2, verse 10 and 11. Watch this. Then the angel said to the shepherds, "Do not be afraid. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." Now, notice what the angels say. The first thing they proclaim is, "Do not be afraid, for we bring good tidings of great joy that a Savior is born to proclaim the love of his Father." Now watch this. This is good news. As Americans, the idea of good news is rather foreign to us. Here's what I mean. No matter what side of the bird you're on, right wing or left wing, like maybe you're an Obama supporter and you say, you know what, Obama changed culture by being the first black president. Or maybe you're a conservative and you say Trump changed culture by being the first non-politician who was elected president, the first billionaire, top 1%er to preside over the 99%. Whatever side of the bird you're on, whether you watch CNN or Fox News, what the news media does as a whole is they constantly proclaim bad news and they repeat their own newsfeed every 30 minutes. So the quickest way to be depressed during this Christmas season is to watch the news 24/7. And here's the thing. News media pundits and corporate profiteers understand that when they hawk bad news, that sticks to the brain like Velcro. Have you ever noticed, like, when you're on Instagram, if 10 people comment on your post and 9 people say something nice, but 1 person says something mean, what are you thinking about? What are you meditating on? What do you remember? The 1 negative comment. That's because neuroscientists tell us that negativity and bad news sticks to the brain like Velcro, and good news falls off our brain like water off a duck's back. So neuroscientists tell us that you have to take 15 seconds to meditate on good news every time it happens in order for it to assimilate into your cranial package. What I'm saying is bad news sells. But this message of Christmas is good tidings of great joy. I'm so glad I didn't have to tell you. Please turn with me to the night, tonight, to the bad news according to St. Luke. It's turn to the gospel according to Luke. The word gospel means good news. And friends, if you're depressed, if you're lonely, if you're burning in fiery tribulations rather than being warmed by an open fire, let me tell you, the good news of God's love is so amazing that he will even take situations in your life that are painful and he will convert them into pain fuel that drives you on to your destiny. Pain either has the power to break you or it is the power that makes you unbreakable. What it is depends on who you are. And when we walk with the God of love, the good news is pain makes us stronger. Tears make us braver. Heartbreak makes us wiser. So we thank our past for a better future. Paul the Apostle said in Romans 5, we glory in tribulation because tribulation produces patience. Patience experience hope, and hope never maketh ashamed because of the love of God spread abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Friends, the love of God works all things together for the good. So John the Apostle said, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, that a savior has been born into the world. Now, notice who wrote that text. John the Apostle said, herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loves us. Notice, John the Apostle was the one disciple who did not forsake Jesus at the cross. Peter, on the other hand, was the disciple who denied Jesus three times. Why? Because Peter defined himself as the disciple who loved Jesus, but John defined himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Peter said, I will go to the cross with you even to the death. And Jesus said, no, you're not. You're going to deny me three times before the rooster crows. But John the Apostle defined himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. And he leaned on the breast of Jesus and actually stayed true to Jesus even when he was at the cross. When you know not how much you love God, but how much he loves you, that a savior is born, that's what keeps us close to his heart. And it's funny, John the Apostle proved what Song of Solomon says, that many waters cannot drown love. There is no social utility or Darwinian explanation or evolutionary principle that explains why we have present tense love for those who've already died. Because the Bible teaches many waters cannot drown love. Love never fails. Love is immortal. So John the Apostle, the disciple whom Jesus loved, the apostle of love, no matter how much they tried to kill him, he just wouldn't die. They tried to put him in a cauldron of boiling oil and he survived. Then they tried to poison his cup. A king actually put poison in his drink and he didn't perish. So then they sequestered him to a desert island and he still wouldn't die. In fact, he came back from the desert island with a bestseller. Because he was the disciple whom Jesus loved, nothing could kill him. And I want to tell you as I draw to a close that the Lord loves you so much. When you're in a fiery tribulation, he did not come to torch you. He came to touch you. Fear not. There are good tidings of great joy, knowing that Jesus did not die on a cross so we could live like hell on earth. Jesus didn't die on a cross just to get us off this rock into heaven, but to get the kingdom of heaven into us while we're on this rock. Jesus didn't just tear the temple veil to get us into the presence. He tore the temple veil to get the presence into us. And our message is not so much that we accept the Lord into our heart as much as he accepts us into his heart. The Old Testament is the sheep die for the sins of the shepherd, but the New Testament is the good shepherd lays down his life for the sins of the sheep. The Old Testament is take off your shoes, this is holy ground. The New Testament is the father gives the prodigal sons shoes for his feet because he's now worthy to stand in his presence. The Old Testament is my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. The New Testament is you have the mind of Christ. The Old Testament law is God saying, don't make any graven images of me. But the Garden of Eden is God says, I've already made images of myself, human beings. So when you see a human walking a dog, you're like, oh, a puppy. God sees a human walking a dog and he's like, oh, a human. They're made in my image. I love them so much. Friends, good tidings of great joy is the declaration that God loves you to death, as Jesus shows on the cross when he says, eat of my body, born in a feeding trough as the bread of life, so we could feast on encouragement, nourishment. There are 1,189 chapters in the Bible, 66 books written by 40 different authors, and 14 of those books were written by Paul the Apostle. And Paul the Apostle told us in Romans 15:4, the reason we wrote the scriptures was for the express purport and teleologic design of giving you hope. Friends, we have enough bad news in the media. We need some more people who are going to declare the good news. We have enough people who mope around. We need some more people who spread hope around. We have enough ears in the world. We need some more tiggers. We have enough people who tell it like it is. We need some more people who tell it like it can be. We have enough people who say, you're gonna die soon. We need some more people who tell us, you ain't dead yet. We need to have a checkup from the neck up. Get rid of stinking thinking. Have an attitude of gratitude. And when we get God's love, we are gonna live our life with no fear. When we get the good tidings of great joy, we will live with zero fear, zero anxiety, zero depression. We're gonna be like Jonathan and his armor bearer fighting 20 Philistines with only 2 men on our side. We're gonna be like David killing 200 Philistines and bringing back their foreskins when killing 100 was supposed to wipe them out. We're gonna be like Abishai, who took up his spear and killed 300 enemy warriors in a single battle. Like Jonathan, David's nephew, who 40 years after David killed Goliath, fought a giant with 6 fingers on each hand and 6 toes on each foot, and he killed him. We're gonna be like Shamgar, who took up an ox goad and killed 600 Philistines in one battle. We're gonna be like Benaiah, chasing a lion down into a snowy pit and killing it with our bare hands. We're gonna be like Benaiah on another occasion, who fought a mighty Egyptian warrior who was armed with a spear. Benaiah only had a club. He wrenched the spear out of the Egyptian's hand and killed him with his own weapon. We're gonna be like Eliezer, fighting an entire Philistine army by ourselves. We're gonna be like Jashobeam, who lifted up his spear and killed 800 enemy warriors in a single battle. Like Samson, who took up the jawbone of a donkey and killed 1,000 Philistines with it. Like Gideon, who took 300 men and put to flight 135,000 Midianites with some cracked pots, some torches, and some people who shouted a lot. We're gonna be like Jesus, who at the crossroads took the road to the cross. Through God, we shall do valiantly. So we're gonna throw water on the fire of our fears and throw gasoline on the passions of our dreams. We're gonna faith our fears, because his perfect love casts out fear. We hear the message of the angels. Do not be afraid. I give you good tidings, good news of great joy, that a Savior is born. God loves you in his perfect love. Cast out fear. Would somebody say amen? This is good news. This is good news. Let's continue to sing to this Savior who loves us so much.